Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents In Endless Twilight by L.E. Modesitt, Jr., narrated by Kyle McCarley. 1. The once-upon-a-time scout ship jump-shifted, and for a moment that was both instantaneous and endless, black light flooded the two small compartments, the one containing the pilot and the crew space that contained no one. That instant of shift seemed to last longer than normal, as it always did when the actual shift was near the limit.
"Interrogative status?"
asked the pilot, a man with tight-curled blonde hair and hawk-yellow eyes that swept the range of displays on the screens before him.
"No EDI traces. No mass indications within 0.1 light. Destination estimated at 4+.
The impersonally feminine tone of the artificial intelligence would have chilled most listeners, but the pilot preferred the lack of warmth in the voice of the Carol Joy. In his rebuilding of the discarded and theoretically obsolete scout, the former Imperial Commodore could have programmed warmth into the voice when he had added the AI, just as he could have opted for more comfort in the Spartan quarters, rather than for the raw power and extensive defensive screens the beefed-up ex-Federation scout now enjoyed. The pilot had avoided warmth in both the ship and the AI. He leaned back in the control couch, trying to relax, as if he wanted to push away a particularly bad memory. He did, and as he often also did, he whistled three or four notes in the odd double-toned style that was his alone. The AI did not acknowledge the music, since the notes represented neither observation nor inquiry. What was past. The two tack heads he had used on El Lido, along with the 30,000 casualties, would certainly draw Imperial interest, but he doubted that they would call impy attention back on him. Not yet. After all, one of the two targets had been CE Limited, in which he, as Sheikh Corso, had held the controlling interest. Now, Hamline Rotter had control, and the former Commodore hoped that Rotter would use the influence that CE Limited represented for the benefit of all of El Lido. He shook his head. He had run through the arguments all too often to change his mind, or the past. What was past. Time to concentrate on the future, on running down the rest of the research leads that he and the Foundation had neglected for too long. Time to refocus himself on the long range and eventual mission, on getting the technology he needed for the reclamation job on Old Earth, a job that was too big for the underfunded and ignored Recor to complete.
EDI traces at 40 MK.
Interrogative signature pattern.
Signature pattern tentatively identified as Standard System Patroller, Class 2.
Course line?
Preliminary course line indicates target headed in-system. Probability exceeds 0.8 that patroller destination is Planet 3.
Former Commodore MacGregor Corson Gerswin nodded. That made sense, particularly since Planet 3 was Byzania.
Interrogative other patrollers.
Remote EDI traces from Exit Corridor 2. Probability exceeds 0.5 that second system patroller is stationed within 100 MK of jump point.
Interrogative other system targets?
That is negative this time.
Gerswin's fingers played across the representational screen, checking the relative positions and travel times. He pulled at his chin. After the debacle on El Lido, he had plunged into trying to tie up a number of loose ends. That had been fine, but he hadn't bothered to update Lear on those activities. Not what had happened on El Lido, but on his OER Foundation-related efforts, the ones she monitored and on which she had to keep records for the Empire's tax collectors and various departmental snoops. First, though, he really wanted to take a rest, one of several hours while the Caroljoy cruised in-system. He reached for the control couch harness release, then straightened. Might as well do the update and send it. The energy required would be less the farther out-system he was when he dispatched the torp, and the less energy required for the message torp, the more left with the ship. Who could ever tell what he might require? From what he recalled, Byzania, while not unfriendly, was a rather tightly controlled society. But first, the update to Lear. Then he could worry about sleep and Byzania. Once she got the update, she could be the one to take on the worries about the latest implications of what he was doing. Not that she wasn't already. He cleared his throat and tapped the data screen controls. 2.
Buzz!
At the sound, Lear dropped in front of the console. The screen showed the face of the man with the curly blonde hair and hawk-yellow eyes.
"You never change," she observed safely, since Gerswin was really not on the screen, his image only the beginning of a pre-recorded torp fax for her. She first tapped the controls to store the entire message and the mass of data that always accompanied his transmissions, then tapped the acknowledgement stud to start the message.
"Lear, finish the Gromtature lead. Your first impressions were right. Leased the lab, took the cash, and left. Nice prospectus, though. Theory's interesting, if not down our line. Might be worth a commission job for one of your friends to investigate."
Gerswin looked down, then back into the screen. In the shadows behind him, Lear could make out the Axel-D-cell shell couch that dominated the control room, and the manual auxiliary control banks that Gerswin had insisted on retaining, even after centralizing the direct controls in the simplified bank before him, and, secondarily, in the AI center. In scanning the background, she missed the next words, not that she could not have replayed them any time.
"Off to Byzania next. Hylarion, the pre-coded accelerated tree grower, heard some interesting reports. Never collected the last installment of the grant. Suspicious enough to make me think the idea worked. Be back to Yadris to check their system after that. Send a report there."
He grinned at the screen.
"Since you're the cred worrier, some good news. In tracing down Gromtature, ran across some business. Managed to broker a lab lease and some other property along with ours. Finder's fee arrangement. Took it personally, but felt some belonged to the Foundation. Means no draw on my operating account for a while. Remainder of the OERF share is coming through the general receipts. Code blue."
Lear frowned. That she'd have to check. Credits were often the last thing the commander worried about. The very last thing.
"Off to Byzania. See you soon."
He always closed that way, she reflected, tapping the studs to store the message in the permanent file. But it had been more than 5 years since he had been anywhere near New Augusta. She pursed her lips, knowing she should be somewhere other than before the console at 20:30 on a spring evening. At less than 70, she certainly wasn't Novud. Her weight was the same as it had been years earlier, and her muscle tone, thanks to her exercise regime, was probably better. She looked far younger than she was.
"That could be the trouble.
she cut off her monologue before it began and called up the General Receipts account and the Commander's Code Blue entry. Unsolicited donation. First V. de Berg, Aerleon. 1,000,000 credits. Codes follow. Lear ran her tongue over her chapped lips. Gerswin and his unsolicited donations ran to as much as several million annually. Where he found them, she wondered, but they always were supported. And his ventures. She really wanted to ask him what else he had been doing besides tracking completed grants and projects and grantees who had failed to report or collect. Always the ventures. Like the fabrication plant on Solor and whatever he was doing on Westmark with that plant protein substitute. Add to that the aliases. She worried at her lower lip with her upper teeth. After 40 years with the Foundation, she could see an accelerating trend, even more than in the first few years after the Commodore's retirement, a trend where things were building. To what, she didn't know, but once again, she had the feeling that the Empire and the Commodore were going to clash. She'd really have to talk to him about it. Assuming he ever came back. 3.
Selen, the nephew of the old Earl?
The deep bass voice disconcerted Selen, coming as it did from the chipmunk cheeks and bright green eyes of a fool. But His Majesty, Rhys Negeo Bartolome VIII, was no fool, reflected Selen, not if his actions in removing the previous eye indicated anything at all.
That is correct, Your Majesty.
Surprised, weren't you?
At becoming the Earl? Quite.
That was not the reference I meant, Selen.
Then I do not understand the question.
Selen swallowed and hoped that the gesture had not been noticed.
That I doubt.
The current ruler of the Empire of Light pointed toward the single small chair on the other side of the inlaid and old-fashioned wooden desk. The occasional shimmer of dust motes that intermittently resembled a ghostly curtain revealed the defense screen that separated the two men.
Have a seat.
The newest Earl of Selen sat cautiously, keeping his eyes fixed on the Emperor. Rhys wore neither circlet nor crown. Wispy strands of straw-tinted hair framed his all-too-round face.
Caution carried to excess, Selen. That warning about Colindraw, the old eye, could only have come from one or two sources. None of them would have had the nerve to deliver it, even anonymously. So I checked the peerage lists for the newly elevated and for recent heirs. Had to be you. Would you care to comment?
Selen smiled. The smile was forced, but with a bit of humor.
You apparently have me on all rights, Your Majesty.
He paused, then added,
I thought I was more discreet than I was.
You were discreet enough, assuming your emperor was trustworthy.
Are you?
Asked Selen, trying to keep the tremor out of his voice.
No emperor can afford to be trustworthy, Selen, except when he benefits by it.
Rhys laughed softly, a deep chuckling sound, before speaking again.
Then he cannot afford not to be.
Celern waited.
As of tomorrow, you assume the position of Eye. Both Eye regents have also been terminated.
Celern swallowed hard.
What else could I do? Either they chose not to stand up to Colindraw, or they agreed. I suppose they might also have failed to see his plans.
Your action makes sense.
Celern nodded slowly.
Unfortunately.
You noted the question of certain nuclear weapons. What do you propose?
Finding them, if possible.
If you cannot.
Trying to avoid situations where they might be used.
And if that fails?
Waiting for the axe to fall when they are used again.
Riss laughed once more, this time a bass and booming guffaw.
At least you understand for whom you work.
Celern, the new Eye, who had never desired the position, waited.
There should be some records. Colindraw implied that a single man controlled them. He saw that man would be my downfall as well.
Celern repressed a shudder. One man? One single individual with that kind of power?
If the remainder of those missing tackheads and hellburners are used in the wrong way,
commented Celern slowly,
that just might undermine all the centuries of peace.
I doubt that any one individual could have that great an impact on the Empire,
observed His Imperial Majesty.
But with nuclear weapons...
The implication was clear. Celern's job was to keep the Empire whole and hearty, including the prevention of any one man from undermining its authority and image. Trust was the glue that held the Empire together, and the Empire was the structure of humanity, the one remaining web binding man in a common purpose. Celern sighed. Riss Negeo Bartolome VIII nodded at the sound from his new chief of intelligence. Nodded and stood to signify that the private audience was at an end. 4. Gerswin rubbed his forehead, massaged his eyes, and looked away from the data screen on the right side of the Caroljoy's control console.
2+ before Byzania Orbit Station.
The AI voice, the voice of the ship in real terms, was pleasant, cool and clear, emotionless, unlike the warm and faintly husky voice of the woman for whom he had named the modified scout. The dichotomy did not bother him, perhaps because he avoided thinking about it. Gerswin rubbed his temples with the thumb and forefinger of his right hand, closed his eyes, and leaned back in the upslanted shell seat. With each totally new system, it became a little harder to assimilate the information he needed. But he couldn't blunder around strange planets without at least a fundamental idea of their government, customs, and legal structure, not doing what he was doing. The standard structure he'd developed with the InfoNet professionals had helped, both financially and in reducing the information to the absolute minimum he needed. But it was still more than he wanted to learn, time after time. And that was a danger itself, since it pushed him toward continued dealings within systems he already knew. He frowned and, eyes closed, tried to sort out Byzania. Government, quasi-military despite the trappings of more democratic institutions. Popularly elected senators formed an upper chamber which could approve or disapprove any law or regulation, but which could not propose either. Laws were enacted by the lower chamber, composed of delegates selected from each political party's preference list in proportion to the total vote in the general election. Head of government, prime minister, appointed from the military by the chief of staff. Gerswin suspected that the preference lists provided by the political parties were screened by the military, which had its hand in everything. Population. Roughly 30 million, the majority on the largest and first settled continent. Economy. Largely agricultural, with enough local light industry to provide a small middle class. 2 mm, mining manufacturing complexes, on the largest moon of the fourth planet in the system. Culture. Yorubo Hismexic, with emphasis on male-dominated honor. Gerswin pursed his lips and opened his eyes. By all rights, unless the ecology was hostile and the population and agricultural figures belied that, the system shouldn't need a military or even a quasi-military government. Bizania produced nothing of high value and low cubage, meaning nothing worth the energy costs of jump ship transport as an export, and wasn't strategically located vis-a-vis the Dismorphs, the Analexians, the Ursans, or the two other intelligent and technologically oriented races found by the Empire.
Search capabilities of Bizania orbit control?
He asked the AI. He refused to personify the artificial intelligence or to program in any human traits, or to otherwise associate it with the ship of her namesake.
Inquiry imprecise.
Do they have the ability to pick out the Carol Joy from orbit if I took her down on the southern continent?
Probability approaches unity.
Do they have the technology to crack the hull without fracturing the scenery if I set down at the shuttle port outside Ilium?
Probability is less than 0.1.
What is their hard credit balance?
That is classified. Estimated as negative.
The fact that it's classified tells me that. What about fax outlets? How many are independent?
Estimate 0.5 of all media origination points, including fax outlets, are independent. No official censorship.
It's a risk, but we'll go in. Evaluate the probability of acceptance. Agent of Imperial Family looking for a very private retreat.
Probability of disapproval less than 0.2. Credibility less than 0.5.
In other words, they'll let me do it, but won't buy the excuse. Well, let's hope so.
Gerswin wondered if he were being overdramatic. At the same time, when grantees didn't collect hard currency drafts, even at bayonet point, there was a reason, and the reason wasn't normally friendly. Still, he needed to get on the ground in one piece, and he wanted to find out if Hylarion had succeeded with those special trees. Caution could be discarded later, if he had been overcautious. It was difficult to reclaim after the fact.
Contact Bizania Control. Arrange for landing rights and touchdown at Ilium Shuttleport. Use code RED 3ID package.
Contact is in progress, the console announced.
The control area went silent. Gerswin wouldn't have to say a word unless Bizania Control and the AI came to some sort of impasse, which was unlikely. A private yacht meant hard currency, and Bizania needed whatever it could get. In the interim, he went back to studying background information on the system, attempting to get a better slant on why such a largely agricultural planet had adopted such a strong military presence. The climate on the two main continents was nearly ideal for cinder bean production and other easily produced foodstuffs. What land areas weren't under cultivation supported wide local forests, generally softwood akin to primitive earth-descended deciduous trees. Some scientists had theorized that the lack of a large moon and/or light comet activity during Byzania's formative period, plus the larger proportion of light elements, were responsible for the low mountain ranges and slow crustal action, as well as for a general lack of easily reachable heavy ore deposits. For whatever reason, it was cheaper to mine the largely nickel, steel, and other metallic deposits on the fourth planet's irregular asteroidal satellites than to sink deep mines on Byzania itself.
"Clearance obtained," announced the AI, breaking into Gerswin's study. "Anticipate arriving descent orbit in 1+.4. Our name is Breakerton."
"Acknowledged,"
growled Gerswin, returning his attention to the information before him. He couldn't afford to use the deep learn technique, to have all the information he needed poured into his brain through direct input, not if he wanted to remain sane long enough to finish his self-appointed mission for old Earth. Deep learn systematically used up brain cells, which wasn't a problem given the millions available, if you're expected to live a century or two only. Gerswin expected he would need all of his brain cells healthy for much longer. He might be disappointed, bitterly so, but it was a risk he chose not to take. At least, when he scanned something, he could choose what he wanted to concentrate on and what he wanted to retain. While it gave him a short-term headache, he hoped it would lengthen his productive years.
"Better than a head full of useless data,"
he muttered as he turned to the cultural background.
"Input imprecise," noted the AI.
Gerswin ignored the comment. He had little more than a standard hour before he should be ready for touchdown. 5. Gerswin checked the public fax listing for Ilium, keying in on all names beginning with High.
Hyler Haten Kerr. Hylert George Kyle. Hylon Adren Ivor.
There was no listing for Jaime Hylarion. Either the missing biochemist lived elsewhere on Byzania, which was possible but unlikely, since the Ilium listings held most of the planet's professionals, or he had emigrated, which was theoretically possible but highly unlikely. He sighed and put the small screen console provided by the Hotel Darmond on hold. Glancing around the room, from the faded, heavy gray, crimson-edged draperies that bordered the rectangular window overlooking the courtyard, to the dull brown finish of the four-postered formal bed that looked uncomfortable rather than antique, to the replica of some ancient writing desk that was too small to sit at, Gerswin felt cramped. More cramped than before the Carol Joy's controls. More cramped than in the tightest flitter cockpit. He stood up and moved away from the desk, stretching. From the landing at the shuttleport onward, everyone had been so polite. "Yes, Sir Corson."
"This way, Sir Corson."
"Will there be anything else, Sir Corson?"
His credentials as a purchasing agent for Rurta Limited, as well as the Imperial passport, gold-bordered, and the maximum credit line on Halsey Ver, showed him as one McGregor Corson, but the locals were scarcely interested in his name, but in the credit line he represented. The Empire might, in time, find out about the name and wonder if McGregor Corson and Commodore Gerswin were one and the same, but the Imperial bureaucracy could have cared little enough about him as Gerswin, and doubtless cared less about him as Corson, so long as no trouble was overtly attached to either name. The former commander wrinkled his nose, suppressed a sneeze. Despite the spotless appearance of the small suite, really a large room divided into two halves with a thin wall, it smelled musty. The violence of the too-long repressed sneeze sent a twinge through Gerswin's shoulders, made his eyes water momentarily. After rubbing his neck and shoulders with both hands to loosen the muscles, he stared at the list frozen on the console. To search for all the names in the entire planetary listing, which began with High, would be enough of an alert to have every security agent in Ilium trailing him. You're assuming too much. Gerswin realized that he had spoken aloud, and that there had been no echo whatsoever. He frowned, ambling around the suite as if to familiarize himself with the furnishings, though he was more interested in the underlying construction. The relative smallness of the window overlooking the courtyard had already struck him, but not the massiveness of the casement surrounding it, nor the thickness of the armaglass which did not open. That the hotel had the latest in heavy-duty portals rather than hinged doors seemed out of character with the antique furnishings, unless Gerswin assumed certain things about the character of the government of Byzania. Those assumptions were solidifying as more than mere assumptions. He returned to the console and seated himself.
Time to get to work, Corson,
he told himself and the sure-to-be-listening agents as he reset the console and accessed land agents. A dozen names appeared on the list. Gerswin picked the third and tapped out the combination.
Cairdizo and Associates.
McGregor Corson, I'd like to make an appointment with Sir Cairdizo.
Your interest, Sir Corson,
must remain relatively confidential.
Sir Corson, I know not how we can help you without adequate information,
suggested the sandy-haired young man who had taken the call.
I understand your problem. Perhaps my credentials would help to resolve the difficulty.
Gerswin placed his passport, credentials, and authorization for maximum credit in the scanning drawer with a blot bar across all three. The thin strip was designed to prevent the scanning equipment from reading the magfield codes contained in each of the three flat squares.
I see,
said the Cairdizo employee.
I will check Cher Cairdizo's schedule. She may have an availability this afternoon.
Gerswin waited, not volunteering more information, but retrieving his credentials from the scanning drawer.
Would you be free at 14:30?
Local time?
Yes, sir.
That would be agreeable. I am at the Hotel Darmond. What is the best way to reach your offices?
After getting directions, Gerswin called two other firms and obtained appointments. Now, if he could get access to another console without using his identification, he shrugged. There were ways, even in Ilium. The important thing was not to be too impatient. While he had more time than most, he didn't have any more lives. He spent the next hour or so retrieving background tourist-type information from the console and reading between the lines before freshening up for his first appointment. Leaving the hotel was another exercise in politeness.
Good day, sir.
Enjoy your stay, sir.
Byzania was an interesting planet, reflected Gerswin, as he strolled down the Grande Promenade toward his appointment with Raymond Simonet's. With the agricultural predominance and the military control, he had expected a climate warmer than the midday high of 18 degrees Celsius, as well as police on every corner. Outside of the man in the standard brown tunic who had shadowed him from the hotel, and the one uniformed policeman in a small booth 3 blocks down from the hotel, he had seen no other obvious police representatives among the light scattering of people on the streets. While there were some flitter-for-hire stands, the majority of citizens visible to Gerswin chose either to walk or to take the small electric trolleys that seemed to run down the center of all the major avenues. The people in Ilium looked like people everywhere, no one extravagantly dressed, no one in rags. Some smiling, some frowning, but most with the preoccupied look of men and women with somewhere to go, something to do. Tunic and trousers were the standard apparel for both men and women, but the men wore earrings, and the women did not. The women wore colored sashes, and the men wore dark belts. One absence nagged Gerswin for most of his walk. Just before he entered the Place Trehome, he identified it. No street vendors of any sort. None. Nowhere had he traveled, except in systems like Nova Balkia, which was an out-and-out police state, and New Salem, with its religious fanaticism, had been without some street sales. Likewise, the streets and avenues were bare of comm stations or public comm consoles. Gerswin nodded to himself. The pattern was becoming clearer, much clearer. Both absences fit in with the total lack of cash. Byzania was strictly a credit-debit economy. All transfers of credits went straight from your account to someone else's. All were doubtless monitored by the government. The principal formality at the entry shuttle port had been to open a Byzanian universal account for one McGregor Corson. Even the so-called free services of the society, such as console access to the public library facilities, required a universal account card. With such tight social control, Gerswin couldn't yet figure out why the military even needed such a high profile in government. Raymond Simonet's, land agent extraordinaire, had his offices on the third level of the four-level Place Trehome, which was more like an indoor garden surrounded by balconied offices than a place for transacting business. McGregor Corson, he announced.
Sir Simonet's is expecting you. He will be with you in a moment. Would you like a seat?
Gerswin took the seat, only to stand abruptly with the bounding and enthusiastic approach of Simonet's.
Sir Corson, I am honored. So honored.
He bowed quickly, twice as he pronounced his honor.
If you would care to join me in a lifty.
A small cup.
The taller palms of the indoor courtyard leaned nearly into the conference room, although sonic shields kept both leaves and sounds out on the one side, while the closed and old-fashioned door presumably kept the staff excluded on the other.
This lifty, straight from New Cholera,
offered Simonet's as he poured from a steaming carafe into 2 crystal demitasses.
To your health and our mutually profitable business.
Simonet's lifted his demitasse.
To your health, responded Gerswin, following suit, but taking only a small sip of the dark beverage.
You are an agent of something called Rerta Limited, you said. Rerta Limited has no real records. Obviously, you are merely a front for someone or some group searching for a large tract of land, someone who does not want their identity known.
Why would you say that?
asked Gerswin. Simonese shrugged his shoulders.
Is it not obvious? You have access to great credit. You are looking at a planet developed enough to have the necessary amenities, but one underdeveloped enough to have large amounts of land available for purchase. Further, you arrive in a non-military ship with screens of a class available only to the court or the very wealthy, and you arrive alone. That means you are trusted but expendable, that you have access to money, but that there is enormous power and wealth behind you. Alone, who would care? But you are not alone. Merely an advance agent.
Gerswin laughed. Not quite a bark, but not quite gentle. I never claimed to be more than an agent.
Ah, but what one claims is not always what is. In your case, however, the props are too expensive, too real to be anything else but the truth. The real question is not just what you want, but why you or your patron wants it. Do you want farmland to provide an estate for the junior branch of a wealthy family? Or do you want a more isolated and scenic retreat for other purposes? Or perhaps a tract which offers both?
Simonese took another sip of the lift tea and looked at the built-in console screen at his left elbow, as if to suggest that he was ready to begin in earnest if Gerswin were.
My mission is rather delicate.
I can certainly understand that.
And my latitude is broad, within certain parameters. While Rerta is most interested in as pleasant a site as possible, and one which is somewhat off the beaten track, economics, especially these days, would indicate that it is prudent for any local site to be capable of being self-supporting, should the need arise.
Gerswin frowned, as if to convey that he did not want to say much more, and waited for a reaction.
That is a rather broad description, and without some general boundaries might be hard to narrow.
Simone's bright blue eyes clouded, and he brushed a stray lock of blue-black hair off his tanned forehead.
The optimal size, offered Gerswin, would be 10,000 squares.
10,000 square kilometers?
Depending on location, resources, transportation, and whether the property is virgin or improved.
I see.
What Gerswin could see was that Simonese wanted to ask price ranges, but didn't know the client well enough to broach the issue.
While price is a consideration, it is not the sole consideration. Rerta is always better served if the price is as reasonable as possible for the value involved.
Reasonable is a term open to a wide interpretation, Sir Corson, and one about which there could be wide disagreements.
That is true. We need a better frame of reference. While I could access the information myself, perhaps you could give me the average price per kilo square for prime agricultural lands, for forest lands, and for wilderness.
Ah, averages. So deceiving, especially when the transactions are large. Do you realize, Sir Corson, that the average Sindabine estate on Kanuno runs about 50,000 squares?
I understand. Have any changed hands recently?
Last year, I believe, the Harandsaw estate was sold to General Fernadsaw. The registered transfer was in the neighborhood of 250 million credits.
How many squares?
63,000.
Assuming the registered price was the sole consideration, that means a minimum of 4,000 credits per square, or given the underlying considerations of that transfer, more likely 5,000 credits per square.
That was a bargain sale.
Gerswin got the point. He didn't know whether the General Fernadsaw who bought the property was the Prime Minister or merely related, but the sale had not been an entirely free market transaction. Simonese was also testing Gerswin on Gerswin's client. A foundation might find Byzania not entirely to its liking, while certain imperial families could well end up playing the local games better than the locals.
Roerta might well be interested in obtaining property where future bargains could be had,
Gerswin countered.
One cannot predict bargains, answered Simonese. They happen, and they do not.
True, and that is why one must be fully informed on the market and the players.
Ah, yes. So many players, and some so well connected, particularly in the land business.
Simonese shrugged, then frowned.
I might offer you some advice, strictly an observation, you understand.
Gerswin nodded.
You will doubtless interview other agents, and some will appeal to you, and some will not. But should you deal with a noble lady, be most careful.
I was not aware of an imperial family here.
Local noblesse, Sir Corson. Fallen nobility of a sort. The name is Cairdizo, and the lady can be most charming. Most charming. You might find her socially entertaining and quite brilliant.
Gerswin nodded again.
I appreciate your observation.
Now, in regard to your search, let me check certain aspects of the situation and I will get back to you.
Simonese rose to his feet. Gerswin rose also and half bowed.
A pleasure to meet you, and I hope to hear from you before too long.
Doubtless you will, Sir Corson.
A tacit agreement had been struck. Simonese had gotten some idea of what game Gerswin was playing and warned him that the locals played hard. Gerswin had accepted the information and indicated that he was still interested. Simonese had concluded by saying that he would see what was really available, or might be, at what real price. The one thing that bothered Gerswin was the out-of-character reference to Cher Cairdizo. Was Simonese tied into security? Did he know that Gerswin had contacted Cairdizo Associates? Why was Gerswin being warned off? Because the lady was sharp and dangerous? Or because security wanted to keep off-worlders away? Gerswin did not frown, as he kept his face pleasant and bowed again before turning to go. Outside the Plas Trehome, the slender man in the brown tunic was waiting as Gerswin hopped an electric trolley for his 14:30 meeting with Cher Cairdizo. 6. The flitter circled the holding west of the thin and glittering green river that split the neatly and mechanically cultivated cindabean fields. The few buildings, obviously used for storage and machine repair, stood at the top of a gentle rise, scarcely more than 30 meters higher than the gentle rolling hills covered with the rust brown of the cindabeans about to be harvested. Gerswin, in the right front seat of the four-seat flitter, could see from the indentations in the hilltop that other structures had been removed.
This was the original estate house of the Guavaras, but when the grandfather of the present colonel married Vilaire's daughter and consolidated the holdings of both families, the estate house was moved to Vilairven. That's about 100 k's east,
added Constanza Cairdizo, who sat directly behind Gerswin, providing a running commentary. The silver-haired land agent reminded Gerswin more of a dowager aunt than the sharp-dealing professional the other two agents had warned him to steer clear of.
Why is this available?
It is considered too remote, and the production levels have fallen considerably in the last 4 or 5 years. Neglected shamefully.
Not much scenery here,
groused Gerswin.
That is true, but as I indicated earlier, were you to indicate a firm interest in this land and your client's desire to maintain and improve it, the Ministry of Forests and Agriculture Development would look most favorably upon your application to purchase, say, 20,000 squares of the adjoining forest reserve, with the stipulation that your client retain all but a small fraction in forest, of course. Still, 2% of 20,000 squares is 400 squares, and that would be adequate for any estate house, landing field, roads, and local produce gardens.
And the normal fee for consideration?
I would suggest something in the range of 5,000 credits with a deposit of 1,000,000 credits on the Forest Reserve application.
Gerswin didn't bother to ask if the deposit were refundable. Whatever she said, in practice, no deposit for special consideration would ever be returned.
Could we swing over and see the Forest Reserve lands you're talking about? I've seen maps and holos, but there is no substitute for seeing the actual parcels.
Forest reserves are protected from overflights, the pilot stated baldly.
How can I recommend Rurta buy something I have not seen?
You could rent a land cruiser, suggested the pilot.
That would take days, complained Gerswin, and I still would not have the sweep, the overview necessary.
I sympathize, Sir Corson, but the regulations are regulations.
Regulations are regulations, I know. But isn't there some exception, some variance for special circumstances?
Ah, an exception permit,
offered the pilot. Then his voice fell.
But you must apply in advance.
Gerswin shrugged and turned to Constanza Cardizo.
Have you any suggestions?
Sir Corson, must you overfly the whole parcel, or merely see it from the air?
Perhaps if I could see at least part of it from the air, I could decide whether more flights were necessary, and then I could decide whether to apply for an exception permit.
Constanza addressed the pilot.
Michel, can you fly the De Marche line?
Ah, yes, cher Cardizo. If I inadvertently stray, the fine is 500 credits.
Gerswin picked up the hint.
Michel, I can understand your concerns about such delicate piloting. Should you inadvertently stray onto the wrong side of the line, I will be responsible for the monetary fine. If you are successful, as I know you will be, and you are not fined, the 500 credits that would go to the government will be your bonus.
Sir Corson and Cher Cardizo, I will do my best.
The flitter banked left and swung toward the low hills 30 k's west of the old Guevara holding. As they neared the low hills, covered with a uniform dark green carpet of trees, with scattered clearings that appeared more as gray smudges, Gerswin thought he saw a faint line of smoke.
Is that smoke?
The pilot and Constanza both stiffened, almost imperceptibly, and the pilot swallowed.
Sir Corson, why do you ask?
It seemed strange. Everywhere else the air is so clear, even in the forests outside Ilium. First smoke I've seen.
Perhaps it is smoke.
Michel brought the flitter around, heading southward, along the gently curved line separating the rising and treed hills from the cultivated fields. Between the trees and the bean fields ran a dust-covered and narrow road. For 50 meters on each side of the road, the ground was grassy, the grass a purple-tinged gold. From his viewpoint, Gerswin studied the forest reserve. The low trees were gray-trunked, the foliage more purple-olive-green than the green of New Augusta or even of New Cholera. He could see no towering monoliths, but a regularity in height, despite the obviously irregular and natural growth spacing of the individual trees. Several distant glimmers, either lasers or light reflected from polished metal, twinkled in the distance, from what looked to be the second or third line of the hills that rose gradually as their distance from the cultivated area increased. About the reflections, Gerswin said nothing.
"The smoke?"
he asked.
"Ah, yes, the smoke. It may be smoke."
Gerswin turned to Constanza.
"Perhaps I understand. Even in the most ideal of societies, there are those who would not work for what they receive, who would rather live like savages."
He could sense the relief in the pilot and the land agent, which indicated he was either off track totally or had reassured them with his observation.
"Yes, Sir Corson,"
answered Constanza.
"We do have a few of those, and occasionally their campfires go out of control."
"And the Ministry of Forests and Agriculture Development is spread so thin that it would welcome someone who could protect and manage a small section of the forest reserve."
As he asked the question, the flitter passed a small clearing, and Gerswin thought he saw the charred remnants of three identical houses side by side before the view was obscured by the flitter's stub wing and the intervening trees.
"There have been other lease purchases granted on that basis."
Gerswin nodded, thinking more about the sight of three identical burned ruins in a small clearing.
"I take it that, in normal circumstances, building in the forest reserves is not allowed? That is true on most worlds, I believe."
"That is true on Bisonia as well. How else could a reserve remain a reserve if any savage could build a dwelling anywhere he wanted?"
Gerswin noted the hesitancy in word choice and filed it mentally for future reference.
"Who actually protects the forests? The Ministry of Forests and Agriculture Development?"
"Protects?"
"Keeps people out. Makes sure that savages don't destroy the trees, that sort of thing."
"All protection is the responsibility of the chief of staff. Any guard duty, whether at the shuttle port or in the forest reserves, is the duty of the armed forces."
That was from the pilot.
"So your armed forces are concerned with both the prevention of crime and the protection of natural resources?"
"Sir Corson, we have little crime here on Bisonia. Surely you have already noticed that."
Gerswin had noticed that, and said so before changing the subject.
"How far would 20,000 squares go?"
Constanza had a map on the console screen in front of Gerswin, and with her instructions and the map, he could see how the combined holding would indeed be a most attractive property. Most attractive. Attractive as it would be, he thought he also understood Cher Cardizo's game. Rerta would apply for the forest reserve purchase, and the government would turn it down. The deposit would be forfeit, unless Rerta could bring pressure to bear, in which case the deposit would become the processing fee, or the equivalent. Whatever the eventual result, Rerta would be out an additional 1,005,000 credits, of which a large share would probably go to Cher Cardizo. A further refinement would be the requirement that Rerta purchase the estate land before it could apply for the forest reserve purchase. If the forest reserve purchase failed to go through, the foundation, in Rerta's ostensible name, would have overpriced farming land unless it resold at a loss, possibly through Cher Cardizo. He almost smiled. The locals played rough. Too tough to be ultimately successful, particularly if a few experienced Imperials moved in. Gerswin could see another smoky patch in the forested distance, which he ignored, as well as a longer flash of light from the same general direction. He could not ignore the three combat skitters, presumably carrying the troops for which they were designed, which zoomed through a low ridge between two hills and spiraled up into a holding pattern above the smoldering patch in the reserve.
"Forest fire?"
he asked blankly.
"I do not know,"
answered the pilot.
"Nor I,"
chimed in Constanza.
They both lied.
Gerswin did not press the issue, but merely studied the skitters for a moment before turning his head to look at another area of the forest reserve.
"Most attractive land parcels, Cher Cairdizo. Most attractive."
Do you think your client might be interested?"
"Roerta might indeed be interested. There are several other possibilities I have yet to investigate."
"I doubt that they measure up to this."
"They may not. If so, then I can honestly report that this is the most attractive."
Gerswin looked at the pilot.
"If there is nothing else you think I should see..."
"Of course. Michel, let us return Sir Corson to Ilium."
Gerswin leaned back as if to relax, then sat up and half-turned in his seat.
"Cher Cairdizo, you are so familiar with so many of these estates. Almost as if you had..."
Gerswin looked down and did not complete the statement.
"As if I had been raised on one."
"My apologies if I have created some awkwardness."
"No."
She laughed, and the laugh was the practiced, easy kind that comes to those who make it their stock in trade.
"My origins would be obvious to anyone raised on Byzania, even without the name Cairdizo. My uncle was once the Prime Minister, before he had an unfortunate accident while hunting turquoise in the Western Reserve."
"Then you moved to Ilium? Away from the memories?"
"They were good memories, but times change. I enjoy the city life and the chance to meet off-worlders now and again. When one has a small household, one has no need for estates. And what I have is adequate, more than adequate for my needs."
"I did not mean to pry."
"No, Sir Corson, you did not intrude. You understand a great deal more than most off-worlders, and for that understanding, I am grateful."
Gerswin turned back to stare out the front of the armaglass canopy at the dim blotch on the brown horizon, the dim blotch that would become Ilium. No matter how he turned the problem over in his mind, he couldn't see any quick solution. Not one that didn't point the finger at one McGregor Corson long before he could track down what he needed. That left the option of action, and of using others to force the issue before his cover was thoroughly shredded. All he could do was wait until touchdown. Wait and hope that there wasn't a welcoming committee yet. Not that he expected one until the locals had figured out how to get their hands on as much hard currency as possible. As he expected, there was no greeting party when the flitter landed at the shuttleport, not if he excluded the small ground car that waited for Cher Cairdizo at the edge of the tarmac where Michel had set the flitter down. Gerswin observed the military style of the landing, which confirmed another of his suspicions. As Michel shut down the thrusters, Gerswin stretched, began to unbuckle his belt harness. The pilot slumped forward over the stick, his beret sliding off his head and onto the control board.
What happened?
Asked Gerswin, swiveling away from the outside view and leaning over the pilot.
Michel,
added Constanza Cardizo. Gerswin pocketed the pilot's credentials and universal credit card as he laid the man back and across the seat.
He's breathing. Heartbeat seems all right.
Gerswin looked at the land agent.
How do you call for an emergency health vehicle?
Perhaps we should take him to the dispensary in my ground car,
suggested the land agent.
By the time...
Good idea.
Gerswin fumbled around with the controls, more than necessary, before locating the door and steps release and activating them. As the canopy slid back and the doorway opened and steps extended, the ground car purred toward the flitter. Gerswin edged the limp pilot to the doorway, climbed out, and gave the impression of staggering as he lifted the man into his arms and over his shoulder. With one hand on the single railing, he lurched down and toward the olive drab of the ground car. The driver wore the standard armed forces uniform and had leapt out to stand by the open front door of the car, his right hand on the butt of the holstered stunner.
Cher Cardizo, what happened?
Michel collapsed right after landing. He breathes, but he is not conscious. Can we take him to the dispensary?
That would be no problem.
The driver raised his eyebrows as he surveyed Gerswin.
We'll just bring Sir Corson with us, Waldron. He is a client of mine, but Michel is the important thing.
As they talked, Gerswin eased the pilot's form into the rear seat and pulled himself in as well, shutting the door behind him. Waldron seated Cher Cardizo before returning to the wheel to begin the trip toward the dispensary.
Medical! Medical! This is Waldron! Pilot Michel, unconscious. Request emergency team upon arrival.
As the car whined toward the low building that was the dispensary, Gerswin could see a glide stretcher and two white-clad figures waiting under the emergency entrance's portico. No sooner had the ground car come to a halt than the armed services medical technicians were easing Michel out and onto the stretcher. The way they handled the unconscious pilot verified another of Gerswin's suspicions. As the medical team bundled Michel off, Waldron turned in his seat so that he half-faced Constanza in the front and Gerswin in the rear.
What really happened to Michel?
Gerswin could have taken offense and been in character, but decided against it. Waldron was more than a driver, more like Constanza's jailer.
He just fell forward. One minute he was fine. The next minute he was slumped on the controls.
Before or after the doorway was opened?
Before, I think, answered Gerswin. I wasn't looking at him at all.
Why not?
Because I was considering what I would do with the land parcels that Cher Cardizo had shown me.
Did you see anything, Cher Cardizo?
No, I was picking my case up from the floor. When I looked up, Sir Corson was looking at the ground car. Then Michel groaned and fell forward.
She glared at Waldron.
And if you are through treating us like trainees, would you be so kind as to take us back?
Of course, Cher Cardizo. Of course. And what about Sir Corson?
Unless you have any great objection, he comes with me. Michel's seizure stopped us from completing our business.
Waldron said nothing as he squared himself in his seat, seemingly oblivious to the lady's biting tongue. The whine of the electrics increased, and the car pulled away from the dispensary. The front glass darkened automatically as the car turned into the late afternoon sun. Constanza sat straight, facing forward, silent. Gerswin followed her example, hoping he had read the lady correctly. As the electric vehicle pulled up the long circular drive to a house, which, while appearing modest by the standards of the larger estate holders, would have been the envy of many an imperial functionary, Gerswin had to wonder in what sort of splendor had Constanza Cardizo grown up. She had referred to her quarters as small and modest. At the portico waited two other men, both of whom wore livery that marked them as servants, but both with the manner of military personnel. Before the car pulled away, Gerswin turned as if to help the white-haired lady from the front seat. One of the guards had already opened the door for her.
"Cher Cardizo, I am not familiar with this section of Ilium. Once we are completed, finished, is there some sort of transportation?"
"I am sure that Waldron would be more than happy to drive you back to your hotel."
"Most assuredly," said Waldron, smiling broadly.
At the smile, Gerswin hastily revised his plans again.
"My study would be best," said Constanza, "since I have my console and the larger maps there."
Gerswin followed her through the double doors and through the hardwood-floored foyer to another doorway on the right and a smaller hallway with rough-finished white walls. At the end was the study, a long, high-ceilinged room with rows and rows of built-in wooden bookcases, nearly all filled with old-style books on the right, or the exterior wall. On the left was a nearly solid expanse of glass looking into the low gardens of the central courtyard.
"Might I borrow your console for a moment or two?"
asked Gerswin.
"Certainly. I will get the maps out."
Gerswin used Michelle's card to ask for the planetary directory and three names. General Jen Curler and General Raoul Greiter had been mentioned in the fax news, while Jaime Hilarion was the name he really wanted. Hilarion was not listed. Period. The generals were, but only by name.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.